Watching, you know, the Arkansas game, I think we did a lot of really good things in the game. I think it was also fairly apparent that when we had mental intensity, good mental energy, good focus, we actually executed pretty well. And there were times in the game, especially in the second half, you know, where we sort of lost our mental edge, our intensity, affected our focus, and we didn't play as well and actually let the other team get back in the game. So I think the lesson to be learned in all that is you got to maintain intensity for 60 minutes in the game, regardless of the score. I mean, there's games out there every week where people have leads and, you know, lose their focus and, you know, the outcome is not, you know, what you would want it to be. So, you know, this game we're playing against Tennessee, big rivalry game, means a lot to a lot of people in the state of Alabama, and I'm sure there too. It's one of the best rivalries in college football. They have a really good team. They're ranked 15th or whatever, and so they have a really, really good team, very explosive. You know, Josh Heupel has done, you know, an outstanding job there. They play with great tempo on offense, which is challenging for the defense, but their ability to run the ball and create balance has been, you know, pretty phenomenal this year. I mean, they run it for like 230, pass it for like 210, whatever, and that kind of balance is always something that is difficult. Their defense is playing really, really good. They're in the top three or four, you know, in the SEC, ranked nationally, and negative plays, sacks, tackles for loss, you know, and those types of things. I think Joe Milton's a really good quarterback. They've got three really good runners who have all been very productive. They've got good skill guys outside. So this is, you know, all around, you know, a really, really, you know, good team. So it's important for us, you know, to have a great week of preparation and be able to maintain focus in practice, in meetings, in whatever we're doing to be able to carry that forward in a game and be able to sustain it in the game for 60 minutes, which is what it's going to take in a game like this.
Let's start right here with Nick.
Yeah, Tennessee, their offense has been known to use a wide split with receivers. What were some of the challenges of trying to cover that?
Well, you know, they certainly make you defend 53 yards wide of the field. And there's two challenges. You know, it affects run support in the box because the guys that are covering the receivers are so far away from the box. It also, they run a lot of vertical routes from out there. So the people that are covering them get pretty isolated because they're far away from whether it's split safety or middle of the field safety. So it is very challenging. And you know, the thing that I think is going to be really important is not to give up big explosive plays, which was, you know, a real issue for us a year ago.
Katie, on the left, middle.
When dealing with freshmen that are getting significant playing time, what's the balance in being patient and letting them learn and grow and kind of knowing when it's time to get tougher on them?
Yeah, well, I think that everyone's a little different, you know, when it comes to that. Some guys are, that even though they're young, they're very mature. They handle their failures fairly well and learn from them. They're focused on, you know, not necessarily the outcome, but what do I have to do to get the outcome? And those guys seem to do pretty well. There are some guys that are young, good players, maybe lack a little bit of that maturity, you know, sometimes allow the success and the failure that they're having affect how they approach the next play. And, you know, that's something that, you know, I try to harp on the players that, you know, baseball is a game of failures. So if you made 2 out of 3 outs in baseball, if you struck out 2 out of 3 times, got to hit the third time, you'd be in the Hall of Fame. So for young guys, they have to understand that if I can learn and grow from the mistakes that I make, not waste the failures, that that will be significant in me making improvement and developing. And, you know, that takes, you know, the right mindset. And, you know, I think the relative degree that young guys have in that area sort of determines how fast they improve.
Come over here to Charlie.
Hey, Coach, you mentioned the negative plays that Tennessee's defense can create. Just how important is it for the pass rush to clean up some of its issues with that?
Well, it's very important. It's been important all year. It's something that, you know, we have to do a really good job planning-wise, and we have to fundamentally play better. You know, it's a combination of both. And both those things are, you know, coaching and teaching things that we need to do better. Guys need to set better, hand placement's got to be better, footwork's got to be better, and got to make sure whatever scheme it is that we're trying to use, that players are capable of doing it without putting themselves in a bad position.
Go to Matthew in the middle.
What do you think of how Quandarius Robinson played on Saturday?
He played good, played very well. He's been a core special teams guy for us and one of our better special teams players probably ever, you know, here. And when he had opportunities to play in the game, he did a good job.
On the back with Ryan.
Going against Joe Milton this weekend, in the beginning of the year, everyone was talking about he could throw it 80 yards plus, but now he can beat you with your legs as well. What are you telling your guys this week about a dual threat quarterback like that?
Well, I don't see, you know, Joe a whole lot different than, you know, what we played against in the past. Milton was there. Guy can throw the ball. He's accurate. He's got a strong arm. That can make plays down the field, which, you know, they take a lot of vertical shots, and he certainly has the capability of making those plays. But he's also athletic enough to extend plays in the pocket and run if necessary. So don't tell him anything different than any other time you're playing quarterback. You can't get pushed by the quarterback. You've got to keep the guy in front of you. You've got to have disciplined pass rush lanes. And got to try to make the guy throw the ball on time, you know, from the pocket. And hopefully we can cover him well enough to make it work in the back end.
Up front with Chase.
How the freshman outside linebackers, Keon Keeley and Yonze Pierre, looked at practice this year?
You know, both of those guys came in the fall. So the guys that, we only had four guys that came in the fall. And because those guys weren't here in the spring, they you know, had to try to catch up in the summer. You know, I think their learning curve has been a lot greater. We're pleased with the progress that they're making, but it's hard to get them enough reps at this time of the year to try to get them where they need to be so that they could, you know, make a contribution. You know, I think, you know, Rousseau was here earlier, so he's a little bit ahead of the game.
Rodak?
I just wonder, you seen from J.C. Latham and what went into him staying on the right side, whereas some guys might have made the move to the left previously?
Well, he's really a good right tackle. He's played really well, obviously, being SEC offensive lineman of the week. He had a really good game in the last game. And, you know, he's big, strong, physical. He's the prototype, you know, right tackle that everybody would look for in terms of having a power guy who is effective, you know, and being able to pass block well enough. You know, there's, you know, I guess you always hope that if we move the right tackle, left tackle, that would make everything better. But I guess the question you have to also ask yourself is, would that make us any better at right tackle? Or do you just try to attack the solution of trying to get the left tackle to play to the standard that you need him to play without making multiple changes in the offensive line? So, you know, we could have a debate about that. Nobody really knows the answer to that, but we have made a commitment to try to keep some stability with the guys where they're playing and get the guys to play left tackle though.
You want to Nick? You didn't have one? Okay. Cody, right here.
Justice Haynes got a few snaps on Saturday. What was your assessment of just the limited time that he got?
He played great. You know, he's been playing really well all year. You know, so we got four guys at the position, and all those guys deserve reps and playing time. And it's really, really hard to get four guys at the running back position to be in rhythm and to play a significant number of snaps. So, you know, Jam played well when he was in there. Cordell and Jace both played really well when they were in there. And Justice played really good when he was in there. So, you know, we're pleased with all those guys. And, you know, maybe there'll be some opportunity for him to make a bigger contribution in the future.
Finish up two more, Tony and then Kurt.
After going over the film, what led to the consistency in the running game? And then how do you kind of replicate that and continue that consistency moving forward?
Well, we did run the ball better in the second half, but to me, you know, the way I sort of evaluate it is, what is the efficiency in the running game? In other words, how many four plus runs did you have versus less than four? And that's the efficiency that we continue to look for. And it was a lot better in the second half. I think we got a hat on hat, kind of knew exactly what they were doing, you know, formationally. I think the offensive line did a really good job, you know, in creating some holes in the backs, did a good job of running downhill. So that's the way we want it to be all the time. So, you know, we just got to keep working at it so we continue to develop consistency in that part of our team.
Finish here with Kurt.
Oh, yes, Coach. I understand your stance on sacks, but I wonder if, and I hope I'm not going over the same ground, but 31 sacks so far this year, that's concerning, and is that fixable at this time of the year?
Well, to the first part of your question, I would say, hell yeah. to the second part is, I do think we have guys that are capable. I think it goes back to that same attention to detail. I mean, there's little things like in certain protections, I know I have inside help. So why would I be beat outside? Does that make sense? So these are not all capability issues. You know, some of them are things that we could fix. You know, when we're sliding out to block 3-on-3, and the guy doesn't slide out to block the third guy, and he runs in and sacks the quarterback. You know, that's a mental error. That's not a physical problem. So it's a combination of all those things that need to get cleaned up: better communication, better execution. And maybe the more knowledge and experience that we get, the more we'll be able to be more effective and consistent in those areas.
All right. Thanks, Coach.
All right. Thank you.